Everything isn't, and maybe everything isn't hopeless bullshit. That's right. Oh, hello there, Derek. How's it going?
Oh, hey, Thomas. Happy Wednesday.
Are you ready for Bitcoin talk show?
Is it that time already? Let's do it.
Sounds good. We're going to start off with a quote from Mr. Chris Ellis from the Chris Before Coffee Show, the show that was on before this show. Here it is, live on YouTube.
Even if it's really, really small, like, on this, I don't want to, like, big ourselves up too much on this channel, but, like, I will anyway, fuck it, it's not bragging if it's the truth, right? But we already delivered, that was the first thing we did, and even though it was a bit shitty and, like, lots of gaffes and mistakes on air or whatever, we were all having good fun, it was just good, honest fun. And we, like, Tom, to his credit, all started off, he's been working his ass off for over a year now, making videos, very little in return. And it was just creating goodwill between people. And even though it was very, very small, people could see the measure of our sacrifice. They could see that we were going out of our way, living uncomfortably. That's proper lean. Proper lean isn't propping up your hipster lifestyle and expecting the world just to give you the money just because you like that nice loft apartment in Shoreditch, right? That's not the point of this. And people that aren't willing to lower their living standards, who aren't willing to be humble, actually, and say, maybe I'm not worth as much as I thought I was, you know, 4 or 5 years ago. I'm willing to lower my living standards rather than force the buyers into paying more for their product. So, yeah, big shout out to that article. We were supposed to talk about Moolah.
All right. Some good words from Chris there, just to start us off. So, Derek, what's the phone number and Skype line if people want to call in today?
Anyone can take control of this show and share their thoughts about what's going on in the world. 0-23-COINS. That's 1-708-23-COINS.
All right.
You can also Skype contact request to Bitcoin Talk Show. If you send a Skype contact request to Bitcoin Talk Show, it will be accepted, and we will put you on the air.
That's BTC Talk. Very good. And we're moving on to our first topic. I wrote a little document for World Crypto Network, and since I want to be public about everything, I'm going to go ahead and talk about it publicly. These are just some ideas on how we can try to up our game, be the best World Crypto Network we can be. I'm going to breeze through them rather quickly, but if you're in the World Crypto Network group, you can check it out. We could upgrade our dress, wear a suit like Derek and I. Most suits can be bought for cheap at the Goodwill. Not smoke, not drink, don't be drunk. These are good basic rules. We're also going to try to do things like the pros, have reminders every 15 minutes, what time it is, what channel you're watching, what the price is, what the top three stories are, maybe a plug for another show on the network. This is a small thing, but once we start doing it, the network will improve. People will watch it. They'll feel like they're watching a network. Got other notes, try to talk shorter, pick up the ball, no silences, and ah, like, you know. Instead, and this is for everyone at home, I did it right there. You can pause instead. You don't have to say, ah, like, I agree, our brains are not that fast. We need pauses. But we can just do it naturally by taking a breath. Go ahead and, like, have a natural pause. I said like. But there it is. Still, I owe a quarter. How to restart the stream, some technical notes ideas, having combined donation pages, improving our operational security, some IT type stuff, because maybe not everyone is familiar with YouTube. Like, I'm familiar with YouTube, but not everyone is. So we're going to need to iron that out. We also want to have a daily document. This is going to be kind of like a Roger Ailes thing, like what Fox News does, because we're going to copy what they do and then use it for good. So basically right now we've got the major stories. We're covering the Hong Kong protests with James Bang live. We've also got some of the Bitcoin major stories. And these just happen to be the same stories that I covered on Mad Bitcoins. Shocking, but true. The Bit license plan won't affect software developers. They keep scaling it back, but not scaling it back enough. Moolah is closing. Moolah, the famous, used to own Mint Pal Exchange, famous Dogecoin supporters, are closing. And we also have our third story that millions of drug bitcoins were seized in Victoria, Australia. So just keeping the basic top three stories up, we'll give this out to the other WCN guys. We'll update this throughout the day. We have a story insertion system for the future. If you're involved in the Podio, you can get involved in submitting stories. So we've also got Bitcoin and Puppet Show. Check out one of the latest episodes of Mad Bitcoins live from Burning Man Decompression in San Francisco. I just happened to walk by a puppet show, and they just started to talk about Bitcoin. They called it Buttcoin, and they demanded a proof of butt, which would be, of course, a picture of your butt. But they were great, and you can check it out. There's also some scenes from the old Burning Man experience in the street there, a couple of concerts, and, you know, just the old Mad Bitcoins interview style, little marching band action at the end. It's got it all. So we're covering the story out of Hong Kong. If you were watching this morning on Crisp Before Coffee, the protesters are being pushed back. We thought that the police might have radio backpacks, but it looks more like they had pepper spray backpacks. This is called a crowd buster. And if you ever see a cop coming at you with this crazy backpack, you probably want to get the hell away from him. The crowd buster can dispense with burn water or pellet fire or fine mist modes. It has a spray that contains a dye that sticks up for 3 weeks, allowing the cops to easily identify anyone hit. It says here that it requires two people to use, one holding the pack and the other controlling the gun. So this could be what they're using. We're not 100% sure, but based upon online photo analysis, that seems to be what's going on in Hong Kong. We've also got Bitcoinists embarrassing themselves once again with their does not go away subscription newsletter button. Serious Bitcoinist, this is bad form. People know this. They're going to see it. Derek, what do you think about what's going on? I've shocked Derek into silence.
What I think, well, I was muted for a moment. What I think of the banners that don't go away, horribly unprofessional.
Bad news, those banners that don't go away. But everything else, that's the recap of what's going on the World Crypto Network. I'm going to try to keep you updated, and we're going to try to get everyone else to keep you updated as well. It's 12:43 p.m. on the West Coast. And you can call in at BTC Talk on Skype or 708-23-COINS. Derek.
Hey, are you on BTC Talk on Skype? Because over here, the Skype line is Bitcoin Talk Show.
On your lower third, it says BTC Talk.
Well, people can tweet at BTC Talk.
Oh, it's confusing me then. So Bitcoin Talk Show, all one word on the Skype.
That's correct. And we've already got one guest who would like to join us. Shall we bring him on?
Let's go ahead and see what we've got.
Okay. We're going to get connected here. You already previewed a little bit of the story here when you showed Bitcoinist.net. But now we're joined by Nick, who's joining us. Where are you calling from, Nick?
Hey there, guys. I'm calling from British Columbia up in there in Canada.
Awesome. Well, welcome to Bitcoin Talk Show. And you had a few things that you wanted to talk about today.
Yeah, specifically I wanted to talk about how important the decentralization movement is into blockchain and creating ecosystems and chains between developers and the community for creating decentralized services.
And you're a developer yourself?
I'm not a specific coder. I'm a manager at NHZ, and I act as a consultant on some other products such as XC.
And what is NHZ?
NHZ is a decentralized asset exchange. It's originally a fork of NXT. It was put to the wayside by their previous development team, but the couple developers kept it going, and our team came on board and saw a lot of potential.
Why is it important?
It's important because an asset exchange, for example, the service that it offers is allowing people to come into the markets of cryptocurrency and sell their products and services and reach more people than they would normally have access to. It's extremely expensive, and you need connections to get on other exchanges, for example.
Okay, so without getting too technical, can you tell me why you think that this is important, or what's the philosophy behind what you're doing?
Well, on its own, it's just one part of the. You want to build a large ecosystem. For example, we're creating a new project called the BlockNet, and it has a bunch of coins such as Fiber, NHZ, XZ, Shadowcoin, and BitSwift involved. That with the idea that the more coins and chains that you have involved, you're decentralizing the ownership, and all the services on the network.
Now, why would the average Bitcoin user care about NHZ?
NHZ, like I said, it's going to be part of this blockchain, and the main feature coming from that is the reputation and trust system.
Ah.
And for the importance of a reputation and trust system, you can look back to the invention of the internet and the printing press, and their main impacts on society and why it was important was because it was able to distribute information. But the problem with that at the time was that there was no reputation or trust behind those delivery systems. So all you had, it was extremely easily manipulate, and the powers that were controlling it, you would have a centralization of the ownership and the messages getting out.
So how does it really work? I get the idea behind a reputation system, like for example on eBay when I sell something and it's delivered quickly and I communicate with the buyer, I get a good rating on that website. How does it work with reputation capital?
Well, the reputation system, not only does it apply, to example, for the asset issuers. For example, if you were looking to have a crowdfunding asset, the person who is looking to fund this idea, they don't have the money themselves, so they would create an asset on the asset exchange, and they would never have direct contact with the funds itself. You would pay a fee, for example, and then it would create an escrow account that uses multisig, and you would have a trusted member who's in the network, and since every user in the network is rewarded a trust and reputation system, this is all displayed on the blockchain or personal in a public ledger that everyone can go and know this person. They act as the third party. So you have the developer who has one key to the escrow account, and you have a developer on the exchange who's a trusted party in the other one. So the developer, to give insurance to the users that they're not just going to run off by both community, the developer himself is presenting it, and also the guy with the other key. So then the funds would be released in not all at once.
Well, when you say it's verified by the community, what does that look like? Does that happen on a forum, or is there a vote taken?
Basically, the developer, he shows what he's worked on so far. He shows that it's actually working on. It's not just a stagnant process. So you could use a form. It could be a video. It's basically just how you're just providing proof that it's actually getting done. You're providing progress updates.
Theo Goodman joins us. We're speaking with Nick Cote of NHZ. Theo, do you
NHZ,
have any...
Yes.
NHZ, excuse me.
Yeah. And well, it sounds interesting, but I missed the beginning. So what's it called? NHC?
NHC. Yeah, but the main idea here is creating an ecosystem of decentralized development. Like the entire network is decentralized, but you also have a complete decentralization of the information via the community of the developers that are coming together. It's better to have people from different backgrounds and expertise all trying to build a solution rather than you have coins on their own present their own solution, and not all the solutions people come up with may necessarily be the best thing. So if you have an outside perspective or someone who's unbiased, they may see that you're missing, so you could create much more.
I get all that. That sounds cool. So I'm sorry, I haven't read a whole lot about it, but I just have an article here. So it says, is this did you fork NXT or what?
Yeah, NHZ specifically is a fork of NXT, yes.
Okay, so basically, sorry, just to get some, I'm just interested. Is NXT open now? Is it open source? I thought it was closed for a while.
I'm not sure on their exact background. Originally, NHZ was forked back in April. So our development team that came on recently, we came on in September. And we put out our own development roadmap, which can be found on nhzcrypto.org.
So basically, I can make my own assets on NHC like I can on Counterparty or Next or BitShares or something
exactly,
like that.
But the key difference of what NHZ will have over these other exchanges is the reputation and trust system. There's no other exchange that people can go there with confidence and be sure that their funds or the people behind these are legitimate or can be trusted or reputable, yeah. right? Using mm-hmm. a reputation and trust system, you're bringing accountability to the exchanges. And I don't know anything in the world other than regulation, which, again, can be easily manipulated. That's why blockchain technology is so important. It can't be changed. It can't be manipulated. It's completely open, right? So, the public ledger system. That's why...
Yeah. So, okay. Well, I'm sorry I missed the beginning of the conversation,
so but important.
Could you just tell me really quick, how does... Let's say I create Theo asset. How do people give me, and I'm a legit company and I've got a business plan and all that, so what do you give me? You rate my asset by looking at my background, and that's permanently on the blockchain, and there's no way for me to get to organize shill voters that just like, you know, sock puppet vote for me on the blockchain?
It's going to be two different things. Blockchain-related technology is going to be a trust index, which we don't want to get into right now, the technical details behind it. But for the average user who's looking into you, it'll be a third-party asset directory that when you're creating an asset, you can go on and create a profile for your asset and back up with any documentation you want to provide publicly. So users will then be able to search through it, look into it, and then when you create your asset, you'll issue the amount of shares that you would like on the exchange, and then people, based off of, they'll be able to look at your trust and reputation system, which will be displayed right beside your name. Then they'll be able to purchase that, just like they were purchasing any other coin that you can currently do on an exchange.
Right. Yeah. And okay.
If you're delivering an asset specifically, then they hold a value in that asset. So they're basically buying a stake into its success and are rewarded upon it.
Why is reputation so important? Why is that a feature that's missing in the other exchanges, Nick?
I think reputation is important because it brings it, like I said, it brings accountability back. It forces the accountability back to the developers, and it shows, creates that trust between the communities. How many times now you're seeing a lot of issues of mistrust or misguidance, especially in cryptocurrency? See, where there's a runaway, really. Creating accountability and trust is extremely important if we want to outside mainstream people to adopt this.
What sort of remedies would be offered if people violate trust, or is it just a lowered reputation score?
Eventually, for example, if you're running this onto the nose, if there's a quote-unquote bad actor, the reputation system, they're continually, let's say they would be downvoted. So eventually, like a cancer, your reputation acts as a part of your immune system that then figures out that someone's not behaving properly and just either blocks them out of the network or shuts them down automatically.
Thomas, do you have any questions for Nick at this time?
Sounds interesting. Keep working on it.
I have one quick question or comment. Yeah, I get it that it shares in the asset, and you know that theoretically has value if it's a company. But some of these aren't companies, or are they? Or how do we tell? You see what I mean? Because if I buy a share in a company in the legacy world, like on the stock exchange, and then a big company buys that company, then I get a kickback. I get my share of the cut, right?
Yeah.
But all these crypto equities, they're so-called crypto equities and all that, well, it's not really clear what that's all based on. You know what I mean? And that there's no there's a stipulation that they have the share of a company.
Types of there's assets. No real
company always. You know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean. But what I'm saying is there's going to be different types of assets or services that you can launch on these exchanges. So, for example, you can just have a strictly crowdfunding asset, which doesn't pay anything back. It's just the people investing back into the idea, just like kind of how Kickstarter works, right?
Okay, and then you just get these tokens for fun, and maybe you can get a T-shirt with it or something.
Yeah, well, or that, or possibly another... solution would be that you then have like more of a voting right, or if you own this coin, you are then invited to a private forum where you can help grow your or this idea, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're not just watching from the outside. Like it's something that the developers would have another we were getting back to. Companies and services would be completely different and operated differently and exchanged differently on the exchange. Some are going to have rewards. So if you have an equity fund or a hedge fund, for example, then it's getting a little more into the legal side of things, and that'd be needed taken care of. But they would pay back in dividends, for example. Or if a company was selling their advertising, then they could pay back their users who invested in this coin in a portion of their advertising revenues, proportionate to the amount that they invested in.
Okay. So at what stage are you right now? Is it live?
It's not live right now. Like I said, today we were announcing this ecosystem BlockNet idea, which basically it's connecting all these coins, their separate chains, and providing all their best features that are going to be available to everyone from any of these wallets at all the times. So it's basically allowing users to access all the features, all the best features of all these other networks and use their power and their node networks all in one spot.
Okay, well, I'm going to check that out.
And that's just the technical side of it. The idea behind this BlockNet is getting all the developers who are involved in this BlockNet working together, and then you can delegate tasks and features. Like, there needs to be forums for conversation on this and creating these decentralized ecosystems. On November 5th, we will be hosting the first decentralized developer meeting and community interest on the Mumble server. We're going to be posting an official announcement on necrypto.org and also on xcofficial.com about how you can get involved and the dates and times.
Is there any significance to that date?
Excuse me. No, not particularly. Just wanted to give enough people
that's
time.
The 5th of November. You know? That's the...
November. Gunpowder and treason plot. I could never... There's no think of no reason the gunpowder treason should ever be forgot. Yeah. Count on me for movie quotes.
It's Guy Fawkes Day, that's all.
There may be more a cultural reference to it more than I'm aware of, but the main idea was just to give developers and white paper that explain all this in written documentation.
Where should we be following for that?
You can be following on xc-official.com on the forums. Any of the coins that are involved on their Bitcoin Talk forums, nhc.crypto.org, or on my Twitter at mbtcpispy.
Okay, that's xc-official.com or on your Twitter. And we'll have links to all of those resources in the show notes.
Perfect. And we invite everyone, like everyone who's interested in this concept, to come out. Like I said, the more people who are discussing these ideas, the better the solutions that are going to come from this.
Ecosystem BlockNet, did you coin that term?
Blockchain ecosystems is what the coin that we came up with, or the name. It's more of an idea. It's not the exact name of the network we're trying to build. The running name is BlockNet. This is more of like a concept. I think there are a lot of other groups or people that have this idea. They just haven't put a name to it. Mm-hmm. There's more value in working together than there are separately, especially with something as powerful as blockchain technology. Blockchain, it allows people to put out these revolutionary ideas, and blockchain is so flexible. It can be applied from telecommunications all the way down to smart contracts. Digital money transfer is just one great service that blockchain can revolutionize the financial industry, right? There's so much more to it. It can completely revolutionize and change the political landscape. For the first time, you could have a vote that can be or an election that can be trusted. It's publicly recorded on the ledger. Can't be tampered with. No accusations of rigging. Everything's there, right?
Yeah, that would be a big deal. There are a lot of implications to blockchain technology. Of course, financial services is just one. Yeah. So what are your biggest obstacles right now?
People not being interested or not understanding the vision or the idea. You kind of lived in this crypto era in the markets where everyone's just after that quick buck, right? And everyone just thought of this. Everyone was cloning everything, and the only services offered were digital money transfer and storage, which essentially is what the blockchain has been supplying or what Bitcoin focuses on. But I don't see personally 300 coins being able to survive in a saturated market, all who provide just one signal service. They need to band to get the teams behind these coins need to get together, put their heads together, and really understand the vision and direction and implications of how they can change the world using their software.
xc-official.com is where we should look for more.
Yes, sir.
Anything else you want to share today, Nick?
I think that was anything unless anyone else has any questions or concerns, comments.
Questions for Nick before we let him go?
No, that's cool. You answered the questions for now. I have to look at it myself a little.
All right. I want to thank you, Nick Cote, xc-official.com. What's your Twitter again?
At MBTCPizPy, and another great source of information will be on the NHZcrypto.org website.
Thanks, Nick. Appreciate it.
Perfect. Thank you. I look forward to talking to people on November 5th.
Likewise. Cheers.
All right. We've got a few questions from the audience.
All right.
Michael asks, when did World Crypto Network begin broadcasting? I get so much from you guys. Keep up the excellent vision for cryptocurrency land. We started about 6 months ago in April, so we're about half a year old, so not very long at all. Josh writes, are either of you guys making it to Libertopia next month? Libertopia is the Libertarian Convention in San Diego. I know some people that are carpooling down there, but I currently don't have plans to go. Derek, are you going to make it out to San Diego?
I can't imagine I would find more freedom in California than where I am right now. So no, I don't think so.
You'd be surprised at the level of freedom you get from the weather. And of course,
you can
Theo,
fly me in.
Brussels.
Fly me in. Buy me a ticket. I'll go. No, I'm just joking.
Yeah. It's a bit of a hike for a lot of the people on the panel. Even for me, San Diego is over 8 to 10 hours perhaps by car. So it's a significant haul. But we'll be checking it out, seeing what the libertarians are up to down there.
Thomas, you'll be reporting there for Mad Bitcoins?
No, I can't make it down there as far. We'll see. Some other people will be there. We'll see. I think Davi will be there, some of the Bitcoin Not Bombs guys. So if they want to, sack it up and get on the air, we could have reports from them. So, but, got to do it.
It's 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock German time, top of the hour.
Yep. So we're going to go back through the stories. We've got Bitcoin drug millions seized in Victoria. Apparently, Australians were processing their drugs using Bitcoin, and several $1 million worth of Bitcoins were seized. What do you guys think about these drug dealers using the Bitcoin? Derek J.
More drug dealers should use and accept Bitcoin. It's a nice, easy way to trade value for value if that's something you're interested in doing. Of course, many drug dealers have a difficult time getting a bank account once they've been convicted or served time in any jail. I myself have had difficulty getting bank accounts for my criminal history, and I prefer to use Bitcoin because I don't need to ask anyone's permission to set up a wallet or to start trading with my friends and neighbors. I just go ahead and do it. So if more...
That's really what this article is. More drug dealers should be using Bitcoin. It's a wake-up call for the rest of the drug dealers. Why am I not keeping my profits in Bitcoin? Why am I not sending money pseudo-anonymously over the internet? With a little bit of work, I think they could take more Bitcoin. That's partially satire there. See how you do that? Theo, what do you think? Should more drug dealers take Bitcoin?
If they want, it's totally voluntary system, unlike, other money systems. Why not? I mean, I think it's just a good news story, and I think it just creates headlines for them if they can do that and they can get some more clicks or whatever. I mean, we don't hear... Wow, dollars found with drug dealers. That's not a headline. Wow, Bitcoin found with drug dealers.
The presence of cash at this crime scene.
Yeah, I mean, sure, maybe. I mean, for the most part, drug dealers you know, using drugs, you have to be careful, you know, watch out for your health and, you know, figure out what you're using and all that kind of stuff, you know, do your due diligence. But, you know, this is not an illegal activity like smashing someone over the head or killing people or something like that. You know what I mean? This is a nonviolent crime, and we got to get the people out of the prisons. The prisons are full of people, you know, drug criminals and stuff. I mean, let's see. I'm trying to think just people I know off the top of my head. I will, you know, one friend of mine was in prison for like 2 or 3 years because he got convicted of drug trafficking. Okay, he was selling drugs, but it's not that. So what? It wasn't such a big deal. You know what I mean? He wasn't like robbing banks or anything. You know what I mean? And he had a real hard time for a while. But I mean, that's, you know, over 10 years ago. And
what's so wrong with robbing banks? After all, the famous bank robber said, "That's where the money is." Right? Can't beat that.
I mean, my only point is, it's not like he was a violent person. He wasn't. When the police caught him, he wasn't doing anything violent. He wasn't hurting anyone. You know, they were just partying a lot, basically, you know, and that's why, and then he got sent to prison. That's stupid. And if they had Bitcoin back then, it would have made things easier. I don't know. It was a while ago. It was a long time ago, but still.
One of my best friends I interviewed here in Peace News Studios last night for Peace News Now, another broadcast show I do, and he was just getting out of jail yesterday for the crime of selling cannabis. Of course, he does trade in Bitcoin because he doesn't need to use any sort of bank account. He can use cash or Bitcoin and has no qualms about being open and honest about selling cannabis.
All right, we're joined by Mr. Chris Ellis from Chris Before Coffee and the World Crypto Network. Chris, do you have any comments on the drug bust in Victoria, Australia?
You need to fill me in.
They apparently found bitcoins there. It's very shocking. Tokens of value were found at the scene of this exchange where people exchanged items that people want, that there's incredible demand for worldwide. We found tokens of value there. What do you think, Chris?
Yeah, well, it wouldn't be very good money if it didn't actually exchange for anything of value, would it? It wouldn't be very good money if you couldn't buy drugs with it. Did they find any Federal Reserve notes?
I'm pretty sure they did. They said cash was also present. They were also accepting. So these are very, you know, outgoing and forward-looking entrepreneurs here. They accept two forms of payment.
I wonder, did it have traces of cocaine on the Bitcoin? Do we know? Have we heard?
They haven't checked the Bitcoin for cocaine, but they are continuing to use the pictures of the cassatious coins. And now 3D printers have been brought in to produce virtual Bitcoins in our next story, but I don't want to spoil that.
Dirty paper money.
It's all got cocaine on it. It's gross. We'll move on to our next story.
Before we move on, I do want to say that Bitcoin presents an awesome opportunity for the black market here, because like black markets, mafias, drug dealers, when they do big business, they do it in gold bars, right? Or they stopped using gold and they started using those $100 bills in suitcases because you could fit more value in the suitcases than in paper bills than you could with stacked gold. So then Bitcoin, I mean, that makes it even easier to carry. So eventually, when are we going to see the black market and these drug dealers using suitcases full of Bitcoin, so to speak? Oh, but joining us, we have a special guest, Matt Mckibbin. Hey, Matt. Can you hear us okay? Can anyone else hear Matt?
My phone
appears to be frozen. I'm not sure we can hear him. You guys hear him?
Then we'll ask him. Can you
hear me now?
Just wait for him. Yes, we can hear you. Welcome.
Okay. I don't know if the headphones were working, but it works better. All right, cool.
You haven't brought up the main theory.
How's it going, guys?
It's going great. It's going real good, and thank you so much for joining us. You were in the news this week, and we were just about to start talking about the story with BitNation. I interviewed you on another show, Peace News, about a month ago. You were talking about it, and then this week I see a resignation letter. So maybe you would be best to summarize what's going on. What's going on?
Yeah, well, I was super excited about this project. When I first came on board, I got to promote an idea, promote a way of, you know, the project, main goal of the project was to, you know, implement and push blockchain technologies, especially into the developing world and people that don't have capital markets. And, you know, when someone proposes you to join a team like that, you know, it's like, hell yeah, let's do it. And over the past month, I guess I've realized, and, you know, may have been blinded by a little bit of idealism in joining the thing, but I realized that it wasn't being set up properly. It wasn't being set up with the legal ramification or the legal recourse for investors. There wasn't a company. And that a lot of the things that the structure of the organization would have been securities fraud in a lot of jurisdictions as well, issuing equity with no voting rights, and unfortunately just mismanaged. Great project, great potential, but not something you have to blow the whistle on when you see it coming.
So at first you were very excited about working with this organization, and
can't hear you.
Okay, so at first you were very excited about working with this team. When did it start to change? When did you start to see things going wrong?
As past couple of weeks, I mean, we were going to set up, I guess, one of the ideas was to set up a holding company in an island nation, and then have that holding company have blockchain assets. And that way you could essentially have a corporate structure. You can have recourse for investors. And then you would have to also, since issuing crypto equity, crowd to equity in the United States is essentially illegal currently, you would have to do a KYC, and you'd have to block US IP addresses. Once I kind of realized that a lot of that stuff was not going to be going on, even though I hadn't really taken any money from the thing, there was no corporate structure, no governance structure for the BitNation governance tool, in which case I would definitely have been liable and investigated had I continued to be in it. Just a lot of the things that would need to be done in order to get this run properly were not there. And so I had to blow the whistle and say, you know, don't put your money into this.
I'm more familiar with public sector whistleblowers. People
who projects don't. It's not gonna work. It's doing things.
There's people who watch governments spending or illegal operations. You're deciding to be a private sector whistleblower, how is it different? And do you feel like you were legally obligated to blow the whistle in this situation? Oh, and so after, I assume it has nothing to do with the questions I asked. I assume it has to do with the technology. But we just
they're
lost
jamming him. I'm sure they're jamming him.
Yeah, so hopefully he'll be able to either join us via Skype or catch up with us another time, but I certainly appreciate the time that Matt Mckibbin is able to share. He did write a public letter of resignation, and hopefully we'll be able to share that with you, and maybe he will rejoin us if his connection is working again. Welcome.
For a second. I'm not sure where you blowers and usually see that, and then I wasn't sure what else you said there, but I think I have something else specific to say.
Yes, please do.
Well, okay, so, you know, what I take from this is that this is an example of the community being able to police itself, the libertarian community specifically, being able to police itself, and even though the project itself had a fantastic concept. The management did not have the business experience to make this ginormously broad project succeed. And especially if you're going to do a crowd sale, you know, they didn't have the white paper out 30 days in advance, didn't have the business or the dev plan and all of that. You know, as a libertarian, you kind of have a responsibility of self-governance, right? And an obligation to be honest with each other and not go to the state when we have problems necessarily if we can work it out amongst each other proactively. We have to be the regulators of ourselves. We have to, you know, we need to be better than the actual regulators themselves, all without the use of violence, right? And so I see this as a way of the community policing itself, coming out, being whistleblowers where they need to be and saying, you know, don't participate. You know, I'm not really, I wasn't really concerned about the big whales, the people that may throw a couple of Bitcoins in because they've been in the space for 2 or 3 years. I'm concerned about the people that this project was designed to help, that, you know, had these idealistic visions where they could have, you know, had these services, had the project worked, and, you know, they're giving $5 worth of Bitcoin in some developing nation, and that's a lot of money for them. And so you have to get the word out as much as you can when that happens, especially if it, since that's the target audience. And so, you know, it sucks. I don't like doing this. It's not fun. But.
Yeah, it sounds like the goals were good and the intentions were good. It reminds me of a quote by Michelangelo: the greater danger for most of us lies not in setting our aim too high and falling short, but in setting our aim too low and achieving our mark. Well, fortunately, this is a situation of aiming too high and falling short. You know, it's at least we have good goals and we can continue to work to achieve them in other ways, even though that this wasn't a success.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, there's going to be other projects, and the people that, I think there were some other people in the beginning that, before I got there, that could have really made this something real and thing, and I think they were kind of pushed out of the project because it wasn't being done. The suggestions were being made and they weren't being heard. So,
have you been attacked for what you've said?
No, not really. For most of the part, most of the community has really been, you know, helpful and supportive. I know that there's some, you know, people that were still in the BitNation that didn't like what we did, but that's, you know.
It's been continuing? I thought it was over.
Well, there's crowd sales still going on. If you go ahead and look at it, and so this is some of the other things that are going on now after we've left, which, you know, I'm glad I'm not a part of it anymore. It was said in a lot of different public forums that the keys to the wallet holding the funds was a multi-sig, and that this was publicly made available as straight up, yes, it's a multi-sig. Well, who else owns the key? And the people would refuse to give the names. You can very easily see if an account is a multi-sig. You can go ahead and take a look at the Bitcoin account you would be donating to your investing in on the site, and it starts with a 1. It doesn't start with a 3. And we all know that Bitcoin 101, you got to have a 3 for a multi-sig. So, you know, that's straight up.
That's dishonesty then, because I asked Suzanne explicitly yesterday, is there a multi-sig address? And she said, yes, there is, but she couldn't say exactly who had the funds. And actually, even if you do have a P2SH address, if you don't, it could just be you having 3 signatures. It could just be you owning all of the private keys. So it still doesn't prove it unless you get them, to each person, to sign a transaction.
But I mean, and right now, I mean, as of right now, it would, modern day multisigs would be start with 3, and that would be very easily verified. So
yeah,
you go on there; it's very open to see, and it's unfortunate. And
that's really sad.
I don't like this. I don't like blowing whistle. I don't like doing this. But you have to do that when you see these things going on.
Where can we find the address, the Bitcoin address that's being used?
You can go onto the site, go on BitNation, put in a public key. It asks you for a public key that you're going to be donating or sending it from. I think it wants you to use Counterparty, and then it'll show you a QR code for you to send. And that QR code, if you look at the public address, I believe it actually, the sales module isn't actually working very well either, because it says 143 XPN issued, but if you look at the address, it's something like between 2 and 4 Bitcoins have been donated. So,
Well, I certainly appreciate your courage in coming forward and saying something unpleasant. You know the expression, don't shoot the messenger. There's a reason for that. So thanks for being a messenger and having the courage to speak the truth.
Yeah, I mean, it was my job. I was the public, one of the public faces of this. I was promoting it. I was one of the, you know, the chief marketing officer, as much as exorbitant titles mean anything in a startup. But, you know, I was trying to promote this, and I was getting in touch with lots of different people, and then to see everything kind of be hastily, you know, shoved forward when it could have, it worked, had months and months of more work and progress and set up an organizational structure and bring more people in, it could have worked, because the idea of giving those developing, those billions of people that don't have banking and governance services a tool to do that is the most high, if you will. And that's where Bitcoin's going to help the world the most. So,
Thomas, you've been doing something here with your screen in the background. Tell us what that is.
I've entered a public key into the bitnation.co webpage. After I entered the public key, it did show me, like Matt has said, it is a key that starts with a 1. So it says 1Q6. So it's not a multi-sig key. And it goes to this blockchain address where they've currently collected 4.27 bitcoins. So in the current conversion, that's around $1,600. So just updating everyone, this is not a multi-sig.
That's really disappointing. I'm so gutted.
Very easily verifiable with these types of technologies. And, you know, it's just a shame. Like,
And just during our last Bitcoin town hall meeting, Theo, Chris, and I set up a multi-sig with CoPay, which is owned and set up by BitPay, and it was really easy. You just go to copay.io, you set up the 3 different email addresses, it sends everyone a key, everyone checks in with the key, and then suddenly we have this Bitcoin address that we can only spend from if 2 of the 3 keys agree. And this is just a lot safer. Especially when you're collecting a great deal of funds like this. So, Matt, you would say the funds are under the control of one person?
That's what it looks like to me. I don't have any specific knowledge. I mean, I would assume that the person running it has those keys, but I don't have any knowledge. I was not one of the developers. I was, like I said, there was a marketing person. I was a communications person. I was in the chats, but I wasn't. I was actually sick this weekend. I had a fever. All weekend, I wasn't really doing that much. I mean, I was trying to at home, but but yeah, it was pushed. Everything was pushed through without the security precautions. And I mean, if you're going to do a distributed organization, you can't have one central point of failure, can you?
There's also the chance that if they don't have a backup of this wallet, they could lose access to it. If they lost their phone, if someone took over this wallet, they could take it over permanently. It would own the wallet and all future donations to the wallet. There's a lot of just basic security concerns that it doesn't seem we're set up here. And that goes back to what you were saying about not having a good business plan, not having a plan to take care of your customers. Like, this isn't just a Kickstarter. You just donate your money and you lose it. People are supposed to hold on to these tokens and then somehow, somewhere, make a profit from them, right? Isn't that the basic behind all these crowd sales?
Yeah, the idea was that eventually there would be dividends issued once the company, if you will, distributed organization, took a profit. And however many years that is, but that wasn't explicitly said how much profit, where. Those weren't, you know, if you're going to ask people for their money, you need to explicitly step out, show every single step of how and what they're going to do. And it may not actually happen, but at least you have a plan. You at least you have all of that. And you know, your business plan isn't crowdsourced. Your business plan is how you are going to provide value for the people in the future, and that can't be crowdsourced.
And just a couple of weeks ago here on Bitcoin Talk Show, we had a representative from the Bitcoin comic book. And the Bitcoin comic book is being funded with Comic Coin on Swarm, which I think is on top of Counterparty. And they were very worried about the legal language they were using. They were being very careful not to say that they were offering dividends, because they're not entirely sure that may be legal. There's also been rumors swirling around about a possible November surprise. People think it might be Coinbase. I think it might be Counterparty. We're all being very dangerous here on the edges of cryptography, on the edges of the internet and the law. And sometimes issuing your own crypto asset, it might be more than a hobby. I'm not sure that it's entirely legal. So we might find out.
Yeah, well, sometimes, yeah, I know about those rumors. There's some chat logs going around about the November surprise because somebody has been contacted, you know. So somebody got some bad news already a little bit, and they just don't know what's going to happen. But just to be clear, Counterparty isn't a company. So there is no Counterparty company. So it's only people that make, that issue an asset using that platform. Counterparty is actually open source project, so you can put it on any blockchain, actually. So it's not them that are going to be the November surprise. And it could also be that just somebody, some company gets fined, or they didn't create a company, and they should have created a company, or I don't know. You could always speculate about what it might be, but anyway.
Long ago, we had Mt. Gox using a personal Diwala account to transfer their funds, and they hadn't applied for a FinCEN license either. So it's very common in these early startup companies. They could make these kind of basic business mistakes, which are acceptable maybe for the first 3 months, the first 6 months, but after a year, the government's going to come in, want their licensing, want their proper setups, right? It could just be something as simple as that.
Matt, you've been very generous. I want to make sure that we're respectful of yours. Is there anything that you want to add before we give you an opportunity to go if you have to?
Yeah, I'm going to go here in a minute. So to me, this kind of looks like the beginning of the internet, 1993, 94. I mean, it was illegal to buy and sell things, right, on the internet. And then the companies like Amazon, things started popping up eventually. So I think that there will be eventually, this technology is not going to go away. Decentralization of this stuff isn't going to go away. And so, you know, some guidelines, all this regulatory uncertainty, this soft fascism, it's going to go away once they issue some stuff. And I don't think will, you know, whether it's good or bad or whether they do a good job is another story. But once they issue something so that there's some certainty in how you can issue crypto assets and tokens and incentivize behavior. I mean, we're going to be able to incentivize all kinds of behavior that we want in the future through these types of tokens, and that's really, really exciting. So, yeah.
Matt, I really appreciate you being with us today. Is there a website or
event
that people should follow you?
I'm Liberty Panacea, at Liberty Panacea on Twitter is my old radio show. And you can add me on Facebook, Mckibbin. I look forward to hopefully working in the space even more, especially after I've come out and shown some integrity and blown a whistle on something. So.
You're always welcome on this network, Matt. We need more people like you.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
Good job.
You can call in, take control, share your stories. 1-708-23-COINS. That's 1-708-23-COINS. You can also send a Skype contact request to Bitcoin Talk Show or tweet at BTC Talk.
All right, I think we're going to go back to the top three stories. The second story is New York State. The Bit License Plan won't impact Bitcoin software developers. Benjamin Losky is changing his tune, saying that whereas before, all creators of altcoins must register with the state of New York. Now, no creators of altcoins need to register. What do you guys think? Is the Bitcoin license getting better, getting worse, still bad? Derek.
I already got my Bit license, and so I'm not concerned once I've jumped over this hurdle. Screw everyone else. I've already got mine. Isn't that how it works in business?
The Bitcoin Not Bombs Intergalactic Bit License is already available at bitcoinnotbombs.com. You can get yours complete with custom QR code. Bitcoin Not Bombs. Just happen to have a sticker too. So Chris, what do you think about the Bit License and its changing tone?
What's changed about it though?
he hasn't released anything, but now he says that he's no longer going to go after software developers. So they're cutting off a large portion of the pre-release threat version.
How does that work, exactly? They're not going after the coders, just the businesses then?
Yep, they're going to attempt to regulate Bitcoin financial businesses rather than attempting to regulate Bitcoin financial business and Bitcoin slash altcoin slash developer slash presumably miners. It's not entirely clear.
So it's sort of like Nick when he said, we're not going to go after the drug users, we're just going to go after the pushers.
Well, I think we should be tough on crime and tough on the causes of crime, like Tony Blair said. How about that? And the cause of this crime are those pesky developers who write the code. Now, this is just going to give people a massive loophole. This is why these laws don't work, because you create a rule, but then there are all these exceptions to the rule. So then you've got to build a whole ton of exceptions. So then you end up with a load of crud in code. It's called crud, where you end up having bad code written on top of bad code written on top of bad code to get away from all the bugs. And what's necessary right now is for us to think bigger and rewrite the whole thing from the ground up by going back to first principles, by rethinking a lot of the early mistakes that we made many thousands of years ago that got us into this mess in the first place. And I don't see very many people doing that. So I don't see the point in aiming this purely at the businesses, because all that will happen is someone will just write the, you know, launch an altcoin, code in their own equity, like XBN, for example, let's just pick one out of thin air, and then just get people to fund that and use that as a store of value instead, and then get around the regulation. It doesn't make any sense. What these startups will do is they'll just create their own altcoins and use those as measures of value.
Theo, what do you think? Will businesses leave New York?
Probably. I mean, it's expensive in New York. They like to have really weird regulations. There's a lot of things you can't do there. I mean, it's a big city, and there's a bunch of languages there, and it's kind of interesting, but I think that it's becoming more and more unattractive. And, I mean, you can just go over to New Jersey, and you're still basically in New York, and you have totally different regulations. So what's the point? You know what I mean? And it's cheaper, too. So, you know, that's one aspect. And I believe that I only read one or two articles about what Losky said, but I don't believe he wants to exclude miners as well. It's just if you're going to give what he's calling financial services related to Bitcoin. Now, I haven't looked into what he concretely defined as that. I mean, are we giving financial services because we're talking about Bitcoin, or, you know, where's the line? I think it has to do, you know, people that are processing or, you know, something like that. And of course, like, there is no good Bit license for a lot of reasons, and for the reasons that Derek said and for the reasons that Chris said. There's going to be easy loopholes. People are really smart now, and it's really easy to do. You know, people are really creative, and you can make an asset, or you can say, oh, but they didn't regulate this one, and they didn't regulate this, and they'll just find the next loophole. And what's the point? Just to do business in New York? You know, that's the whole thing. The main thing is this going to be used as a standard for other states in America? Are other states going to look at this and say, hey, this is how New York did it, we should copy that? I hope not, and I don't think so. I mean, there already were one or two states that didn't say, hey, we're not doing it like New York, but they said, this is how we're doing it, we're going to use the laws we already have. They're not going to make special laws.
And that's just exactly what they should be doing, using the laws they already have. They shouldn't be creating a special class of laws for Bitcoin or trying to understand it differently than money. If they have money transmitting rules on the books, they should go with those. It shouldn't be so cryptic. It shouldn't be a big power grab for the next century of digital control, but that's what they're turning it into. Any more final thoughts on this, you guys, before we move to next issue? All right, moving on to issue 3. Moolah is closing its doors. Moolah, famous supporter of Dogecoin and Dogecon, recently tried to take over the MintPal exchange and ended up closing their doors. What do you guys think about the Moolah MintPal collapse, Derek?
I don't think of it. It was never important to me.
Just another exchange, like a tree falling in the woods. Who cares?
Honestly, yes. I mean, I'm sorry, but like...
And sadly, yes, people have made losses today. People had money in the Mint Pal exchange. There's still a chance you might get your money out there working on negotiations. But once again, a money exchange is a countertop. You come and you put your money down, you exchange it for other money, and you walk out with your money. If you store your money on that countertop, it could blow away. Someone else could take it. It's not a bank. It's an exchange.
The other thing that's worth saying here is like that all these businesses, these startups and these people who are losing their jobs and going out of business, it's not like they're all ending up sleeping on cardboard in the streets. Like everyone's pretty much okay. People's lives continue. They're going to go and do their next thing. They're going to continue developing in the space. Like I think it's easy to get wrapped up and talk about like, oh, they're closing down as if it's like some... disaster. Like, it's just a matter of course. That's how business works. Businesses start up, businesses close down. Okay.
They probably will get jobs at other startups. Chris, yeah. What do you...
No, that's not quite true, because I think what we're seeing now that's a bit different before is that we now own the means of our own production, and that means that we often bring our own tools to work. It means that not every person does the job in the same way. You hire two UX designers and they'll both do the job in a very individual way. And that makes the HR recruitment process completely different, to the point where HR are now just scanning in CVs because they get so many of them that they don't even bother interviewing people anymore, at least not very well. And all of this leads to a period of uncertainty like we've never seen economically before. We've never been here before. Things are never going to go back to the way they were before the crash, because my hypothesis at the moment is that the internet itself is what's causing this downturn. It's because information travels so quickly now. In the past, you could make profit as long as a small group of people had privileged information over an outside group of people. That's where the profit came. It came from the inefficiencies. And I think since the interconnectedness across the globe has risen exponentially since the First World War in the 20th century, what we've now seen is, well, we saw a brief period of huge amount of profit. I now think that that's going to end, and I think that's why everyone is rushing to physical land and oil and things of you know, absolutely that everyone needs in order to live. Everyone has to live somewhere.
Wait a minute. Value can be created.
What? I didn't say it couldn't. What I'm saying is that what tends to happen now is that when you spend your money, all you're really doing is just kicking your money up to the top of a pyramid, right? Because the people that have most of the wealth tend to just lock it away. That's why you're seeing this rush to land. That's why in the UK, like less than 4% of the UK population own more than 50% of the land. And it's very, very difficult to work out who owns it. And they do really sly things, like they'll just like buy some unclaimed land and they'll put a fence around it. And as justification, they'll put a bit of cattle in there, right? And they'll say, oh, well, we need to fence this off for public safety. And then 10 years roll by and then all of a sudden they're making a legal claim to the land and then they start building on it and that kind of thing. And I don't think those jobs are ever coming back, and I think that we're starting to see a conflation between our leisure time and our productivity time. The reason why I do agree with Derek, actually, yeah, kind of didn't care about it either, but I do care in general about the what I see as just the waste of human capital. I just think a lot of these people, I don't hold anything, no, that's not true. I do hold something against these speculators. But I don't think that they shouldn't be allowed to speculate. Absolutely, it is their freedom to go and speculate. I just think it's a shame, that's all, because I just think they're wasting their time. The average trader never makes more than the expenses on their account. And it's like, why are we placing all the value in predictions? We are terrible at making predictions as humans. We always have been. No one can know the future. By definition, it's unknowable. So why are we creating all this value around speculation when clearly we're not very good at it? And it just doesn't seem like, oh, why don't you learn a skill or a craft or, like, just set up a YouTube channel, right? And I think as a result, you know, like we were saying on my show earlier, what happens is honest people who do good work end up not getting rewarded because there isn't enough money to go around. That would be my take on it. But yes, otherwise, I agree in this particular case, I didn't really care about it either.
Wait, running around buying oil and land like Mel Gibson in The Road Warrior. Sounds pretty rough, Chris. And I think you're going back to that idea. I don't know the reference. It might have even come from your shows, but there's a professor that's saying profit is actually inefficiency. and that profit is being worked out of the system as the system becomes fully efficient. And if there is no more profit, then it's an ultimate efficient system that you can't mess with because of the efficiency, but at the same time, the profit allowed our society. We need to grow in order to extend this fiat marketplace situation we have going on. If we don't grow, we don't pay back the interest. If we don't pay back the interest, they don't loan us more money if we don't grow, etc.
Zero or even approach zero as long as new things are invented. I don't know where this a crazy economic theory of like profit is disappearing came from, but
there's not really any new things. The money is all made by money within the system, so it's a self-recycling fiat system that has to grow. It doesn't matter like if we favor growth or fast growth, slow growth, whatever.
There's not new things.
It's the economic value of the society. I mean, it's an economically organized society. The capitalists fought the communists during the Cold War.
I mean, it goes down. Look, it goes down to is anything new at all in the whole world?
Flying cars would be new, and I want those now.
Everything comes from something, or nothing comes from nothing, or you see what I mean? It just comes down to all that philosophy.
It's a bunch of philosophy baloney. Flying cars would be a damn new thing, and I would pay a pretty penny for one.
No, it's human imagination.
Okay, that's cool.
Theo, this human imagination.
Flying cars out of the existing minerals. The only real new thing that can come into this closed system that we have would be if we developed like an asteroid with gold on it, and we could suddenly mine this golden asteroid. That's the only new material we're going to get is new mineral developments, things we don't already have.
No, I'm sorry. That's simply not true. You've got human imagination. We think of things. We create art. We compose music. We do all kinds of things. Don't be so daft. Just because something has... Yeah, you have the law of conservation in physics, which is the idea that matter and energy can't be created or destroyed, of course. But there are still things that haven't happened yet, that haven't emerged into the present perception of reality, that we then find value for. The problem is...
They're not going to reinflate the bubble. The bubble was inflated. It was the biggest bubble ever. And in order for everyone's value to go back to where it was, we have to reinflate the bubble to a level where it's never going to be reinflated. We have downward spiral problem.
Massive category errors going on, okay? No, what happens is they inflate the money supply quicker than the real value emerges in the economy, thus essentially devaluing the money supply because you have too many units of account to describe a dwindling amount of value being created because everyone is diverting their attention onto things they shouldn't be diverting their attention onto instead of creating the real value. Meanwhile, the banksters are taking that money and putting it into real value like land, which we all need, and oil, which we all need. All of this runs on oil, and we all have to exist. So it's an interval play. They're playing the timing of the market. They're creating money, giving it to themselves first, putting it into stuff of value, and then dumping it on everyone else.
Yeah, that's pretty much what's happening. And there's also another reason why they're buying the so-called real things, like land and so on. It's because... It's part of reaching for straws and trying to hold on to what's going on because the interest rate has been made so low that the bank investors can't make money the way they used to. They used to just buy so-called safe investments and they could get 1% from just moving the money around. And now they have to look for other ways to make money and other investors, and now they buy things like land, and then that market gets all pumped up, and then the central bank thinks, okay, we're pumping the economy full of money like this because we've kept the interest rates really low. See what I mean? I wanted to say something about Moolah before we move on. Okay, really quick. Okay, so I agree. I never did any business with them, but I just think it's an example of that you should follow your gut feeling because I watched the leaked video. So what happened was the Moolah guys had an argument with someone from the Doge community, and whether the Doge community guy was trolling them or not is not really the point. The point is that on the video you saw the guys that were running Moolah, and they were really being assholes basically, you know, and I was like, I'm not doing business with these guys.
And can you be more specific?
Yeah, they were basically threatening this guy. So basically, the Doge guy said on Reddit, please show us an audit of all your stuff. We don't think you have what you have. I don't remember exactly what he said. And then they got into a Skype chat together, and this film of the Skype chat with video was leaked. And what happened was the Moolah guys were really pissed because they had a shitstorm from this guy on Reddit, who they call like a troller, right? Because Moolah didn't handle it correctly. Instead of saying, oh, okay, we'll get on that and we'll figure out how we can show you guys, they were like, you don't need to question us. We're a legit business. Instead of really just answering the question. And then on the Skype chat, it just escalated to the point where basically the Doge guy, the guy from the Dogecoin Reddit, was like, okay, can you guys just show us, you know, don't, I'm sorry for trolling, but can you just kind of, you know, show us an audit or whatever? And the guy is basically saying, you are defaming me on the internet. My lawyers are going to get you. Do you know English law? I am this and this company. We're registered here. Do you even know who you're talking to? Who the hell are you? And he's like, look, I'm the guy on the Doge Reddit. Can you please audit? Because, you know, everyone is wants to know if you really have the funds. And he's like, we are. You said that we're not a registered company. We're registered, blah, blah, blah. You see what I mean? And they were just the way they did it. And from that point on, I was like, there's no way I'm going to go anywhere near these guys. You know, even though maybe that guy was correct under a legal standpoint that the guy was defaming them, I don't even know because I'm not a lawyer, so I'm not even going to go there. But well, just right. The tone...
You have to trust your feelings. And when you get a bad feeling about something, you should stick with it. And a lot of these companies, there's no other way to judge them other than your feelings. And when I looked at the BitNation site, I was like, wow, this is really slickly produced. That doesn't make me trust it more. It made me trust it less. We have a question from Silver Miner. He says, anybody got any new developments on the Moolah front? I heard Brock Pierce showed some interest. Any updates? I haven't heard anything other than that some of the articles have mentioned that Brock Pierce might want to buy the Mint Pal exchange. He had wanted to buy the Mt. Gox name before, presumably to run an exchange to get customers' money back. It's complex. He definitely seems to be shopping for exchanges generally. Anyone have any more info on the Moolah story? All right, so we're going to move on to our next story, which probably just a recap of some other stories. They were talking on Chris Before Coffee this morning. I want to bring this up to you, Chris. They're saying that possibly the Hong Kong police had a backpack radio, but it also could be a crowd buster pepper spray backpack. This is a special pepper spray backpack that requires two people to use, one person to hold the canister and one person to hold the gun part. It has
sprays you with democracy.
It's going to spray you with democracy. It'll make sure that, and it also has a dye in the democracy that'll stick to your skin for up to 3 weeks, allowing cops to identify people that were at the protest or gathering, as it used to be called. Petitioning your government for a redress of grievances. But yeah, Chris, what did you think? Was it a pepper spray cannon that they were marching around with? I know James was really close in the footage.
Well, it didn't look like a radio, did it? Radios don't need to be that big anymore. Like, this isn't the 1940s.
It's kind of a World War II radio, I guess.
Yeah, so I can't see it being that. And it looked like it was containing something liquid because it was, you know, looked well sealed. And it had this kind of spring on it, didn't it, as well, that suggested some extendability of the tubing on there, the piping. The pipes on it look too big to be electrical, so I'm guessing it's some kind of projectile, and what you're showing me there could well be it.
Update on what's going on in the Hong Kong situation. The police do appear to be moving the protesters around in a crowd control type situation, taking territory, taking barricades, moving them from one end, moving them to the other end. It's definitely some crowd control going on. We have a couple more questions, and then I'm going to throw it back to Derek. Let's see. Silvermeyer asks, does anyone check out the Introduction to Cryptocurrencies course from the University of Nicosia? He says it's interesting, and the first lesson on the history of money was released today. Obviously, my hope is that it's set up similar to the Stanford or Harvard online projects for MIT, where you can just go into iTunes or iTunes U, they might call it now, and you can subscribe and listen to the lessons for free. I'm not sure if it's a paid system or not. Has anyone heard of this university? Nope, but everyone should check it out. Cyprus.
It's in Cyprus. I think it's the one on Cyprus, and I think that it does cost, but they might have a free one and one that costs, but I'm not sure. But I think that's the one on
Cyprus. If it costs, you should get some kind of a certificate, some kind of proof that you've taken the course. Of course, everything up and down right now. We don't know the value of those certificates, so buyer beware. See, Theo, do you have more to add?
Do we need to make our own certificate, like a course?
Possible. I mean, we could definitely start certifying people. We know our friends at Bitcoin Not Bombs have made the Bit License, which is an intergalactic certification, and you know they have no right to do that. They can do whatever they want, even print stickers for antiwar.com, another cool organization. I just have some stickers around here. So, Dogecoin. There you go. But and Derek's got an anti-war flag pin on. Very cool. More Davi wear. Let's see. So we'll check that out with the Cryptocurrency University. Armando's got a question or maybe a comment. He's waiting for Chapo Guzman and his crew to come out with their own crypto-backed commodities for use in his organization. One narco Carrillo, and everyone he knows is on board. Crypto commodities, buy now, get high later. I don't know who Chapo Guzman is, but presuming he's some kind of Scarface-like cocaine dealer. And imagine if a cocaine dealer created his own cryptocurrency and then demanded that his people use it throughout his organization. He could really revolutionize things now. That is a Scarface with a computer edge. There you go. That's your movie right now. It's Scarface meets War Games. I'd watch that.
You're presuming that there aren't other cocaine dealers, that people can't easily switch from one to another.
It's only Scarface, and if the Scarface network suddenly only takes cocaine coin, well, you better all get on board, because, you know, he's got a little friend.
I see.
So everything's like in the movies. Let's see, we got some more questions. Armando also says, this is just like in the beginning of the internet or video games. No one knows where this is going or what it'll look like even next month. The new paradigm is still being Python coded. I think that's a good thing to note. Even if you're part of one of these cutting-edge projects like Ethereum or MadeSafe or even BitNation, you could be part of the right project. You could be part of the wrong project. You might not even know it. You might be fooled by the people at the top. Everyone's got to work on the basics, business plan, roadmap, outline, public communication. Tell people what your goals are, what you're trying to do. Begin with the end in mind. All the different seven habits, you know, sharpen the saw. Being on board. Let's see, two more messages in the chat. There's a theory that all sound comes from one sound. Have you heard that sound?
No, I was just... Sorry, I was just...
There's a philosophy there in the chat. Let you guys throw me off.
It's because we had this thing, there's no new ideas and all this stuff. And I didn't want to say, of course there's imagination. That's not my point. And I don't think, and Derek, I don't think that anyone is saying there won't be profit in that there won't be, like, businesses and stuff like that, but it could be, but what it is that a lot of profit is generated by playing the game. That's what Chris was saying, you know, about this, like, having insider information about when the inefficiencies are going to take place and taking advantage of the inefficiencies and playing on them, and that's not really, like, creating a value in the sense of like an object or a utility that you can use. You know what I mean?
I do. I get that. My only point was just that humans have unlimited wants and needs. It's one of the basic fundamental rules of economics, the reason why we have the study of economics, and that if humans have unlimited wants and needs, there's always going to be opportunities for profit, and especially with time preference, because we're mortal. So long as we live forever, we're going to have a time preference.
And also, context changes. So even though nothing is new, even though it's not new, the context is different each time. That same idea. And actually, Plato, that's the Platonic forms, right? You had form and matter, and matter was what changed, and form was what was solid.
Exactly. That's what I wanted to say. You know, we've got like the same colors and we can combine them in different ways and all that stuff. And with music, I mean, if you get into some of the weirdly crazy philosophy, that's what I was saying, is that there is a theory. I don't know who thought of it or who told me about it, but yeah, there's a theory that all the sound and that we know about came from like one sound, because the sound doesn't go away. The sound waves just disperse. You see what I mean? And so it just, it all came from one sound. And you know the film Altered States? Have you seen that? No?
No.
Well, you've got to see it, so I can't ruin it for you. But he heard the first sound ever created in the film. And that's what, like, is the, you don't always catch that when you watch it, but that's like what he was like kind of going for. It's kind of hard to explain.
I think I've heard that sound.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, anyway, I don't know if it's we were getting into some kind of philosophy there about new things. But it doesn't mean that we can't create cool music or cool new things or have cool new discussions.
Yeah, just because, well, I've got one. How about this new cool idea? The World Crypto Network is a new idea, and that's one that we've seen in play, like this decentralized news reporting from around the world. I know I've been out of the loop for a past couple of weeks, so I haven't been able to follow very closely what's going on with James Bang, but maybe you guys can tell me how that's been going, because we've got some decentralized reporting through the World Crypto Network from James Bang, reporter on the ground embedded in Hong Kong. So tell me about that.
Well, I think one of the highlights was that he really has been reporting often and a lot, and Chris and Jamie has been doing a lot of the hangouts, and I joined in sometimes. And one of the highlights is that we were able to use Bitcoin in a really cool way. So what happened was James was like, okay, there are a lot of people on these protests. Why don't you guys send Bitcoin to me, and I'll feed these protesters that are outside, you know, like all day, and, you know, they have like snacks or whatever, but they didn't really have warm meals. And so people donated. They put it on Reddit, and people donated Bitcoin, and then he just took his own money. He just took the Bitcoin. I think he just took his own money then. He didn't exchange it. He just exchanged it himself and bought a whole bunch of food and gave it to the protesters, but he documented it all. So it's all on video. So you can be like, he's like, okay, I'm going to buy the food from the donations for everybody, and he videos it and shows it. So it just shows that, you know,
so key, that personal responsibility, personal accountability for his actions, proving it to people, you know, that is key to the future of accountability. I just love it. Good on him. Sorry to interrupt you. What are we looking at here, Chris?
So this is James taking a hit for us. He got whacked by the police officer's baton.
Wait a minute. Taking a hit for us? What do you mean by that?
Well, he had his camera, and the police were starting to take down the barriers. This is a few days ago now. And he got whacked in the knee, and I think he said in the arm as well. And he had some kind of nervous shock as a result. He was unconscious for 10 minutes, and he was convulsing. I'm not going to show you the video on air because it's quite disturbing. In fact, so disturbing that I had it on my screen, and someone actually came up to my laptop and closed the lid. He was like, I can't look at that. That's really horrible. And it looks really, really disturbing. So the police were just really, really, really nice to him after that. He got looked after, he got taken to hospital, the Chinese government paid his medical bills, didn't get any kind of paperwork, it all got streamlined. And there were crowds and crowds of people. It got into the mainstream news. And, you know, and also he doesn't want me to tell you that he's also been hurt today as well. He explicitly said don't tell anyone because, like, I don't know, the guy just deserves more respect than he is inviting for himself. Like, he's taking, you know, he's not hurt too badly. Like, he last I spoke to him, like, he went into hospital. He's going to kill me for saying it. But the thing is, like, he's showing such courage for us. And so, say again?
Where can people follow his videos? He's taking all these hits. I mean,
well, on the World Crypto Network, we're here. I mean, he is, for the most part, he's been able to get online so long as one of us has been awake. And now we have Travis, whose surname I forget. Sorry, Travis, I haven't met Travis before. I only briefly met him last night. And
so James doesn't have his own thing going?
No, he's an audience member of this show, of the World Crypto Network. He's been a fan of ours for some time, and he wrote to me, video called me to say how, you know, much he liked the show and how I'd inspired him to quit his job and all this stuff, and could he donate and get involved? And I'm like, yeah, of course, you know. And so then the next thing we know, there's protests kicking off in Hong Kong as a separate issue, and he's like, right, I want to do this. I want to be a citizen journalist. And he's doing it for his daughter. He's doing it to protect her future. And he runs out with his camera. He goes right up to the police in their face, just like you, Derek, right? And he's like, but these guys don't mess around, you know.
I was really concerned about him from afar, having had the experience of being, you know, at Occupy Wall Street and some of the other Occupy movements being brutalized by police here in my home city of Keene, New Hampshire. I really was scared for James when I saw what he was doing.
Well, and part of the problem might be, sorry, it's breaking up for me.
You can get badly hurt in a place like that. That's why I was concerned for him.
Yeah, and also the thing is, what was worrying me was that he is actually now, you know, in a weird sort of way, more powerful than the police are, because he's got a live webcam. And it's not like it's recorded and they can seize it. You know, they have to physically take the phone off of him and cut the phone off before it caches to the internet. And they just obviously don't believe that. So as soon as he points the cam and he says live, 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 they all of a sudden take a standoff position, because this is really a PR war. You know, China really, really wants to get the gas from Russia. Russia really, really would prefer to give the gas to the Chinese so that they don't have to give it to Europe, so they've got more leverage in eastern Ukraine. This is a global political war of scarce resources, and the Chinese don't want to be embarrassed on the world stage. And this is where the front line is. And I'd rather, frankly, that the front line was in the halls of dialogue rather than on the streets fighting.
Well, why do they have to be? Why does James decide to go to the streets?
It's more, they have to communicate this way because the only tool the state has is a hammer. So all they're going to do is they're going to come in and they're going to bang their hammer on this situation. The protesters try lots of things. They try sitting in the street. They try voicing their demands. Recently, the government moved as if they were going to meet with the protesters, probably just a massive feint, a deception. And then they didn't meet with the protesters. Then they started the crackdown. So it seems the government's been duplicitous the whole time. They never intended to meet with them about dialogue, regardless of how peaceful, polite, organized, clean, helpful, etc. that the protesters were. This is a very extreme case. We all complimented the Hong Kong protesters during the protest, how polite, how organized it was, how they were picking up trash. You're not going to get a much better example, but still, look what tool the state uses.
Yeah, so is the strategy going to change now?
I'm not sure what their strategy is.
What do you mean, for who?
I don't think they're going to get militant.
The protesters, no, not the government, I mean the protesters. No, I mean, going out into the streets and demanding stuff doesn't work.
It worked for Gandhi. That's pretty much our major example here. He got the entire British government to leave
people
India.
People preparing it to Tiananmen Square, I guess. That's what the Chinese government is trying to avoid.
I think they didn't want to go out on the street. I think it was like, it was a kind of a freak thing to start, because they had the idea to do like a 1 or 2 day protest. But what happened was the police got really nervous before the 1 or 2 days before the protest even started. And they assaulted, I think, this lady and some other people that were in the park. And then just everything escalated. So that's the history of why this happened. And I guess that, they're not going to go home until, you know, the government promises them something. What they want is better voting rights right now. Because right now, it's just ridiculous what the voting rights.
It is very dangerous that they are putting themselves in this sort of situation for almost no gain.
Well, no, hang on, they're not just protesting, though. They're also creating art. They're setting up little small businesses. You can buy and sell things there. It's really beautiful, actually, because they're just doing things.
That is worth doing. Setting up businesses, creating art, that's something that changes the world.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
Standing out in the streets and arguing with police and getting...
Yeah, that's right. No, you're right. I mean, people were doing homework and like there was some tutoring going on. There's all this stuff because also the kids don't get proper educations. There's also, you know, there's an intergenerational thing. There's a lot of parents there who want a better Hong Kong for their kids because they can see that the Chinese government is trying to subsume it as part of the state.
Yeah. Well, I wish them a lot of luck, and I am so sorry to see that our reporter on the ground is being brutalized, not once, but seemingly multiple times now. And my heart goes out to him and all the protesters who are remaining peaceful and staying creative about their solutions.
And the protesters aren't doing nothing. They're stopping the government from being able to go with its business in those areas. They've shut down the commerce in those areas. At one point, they had claimed the outside of the police station, so they're limiting the ability of the police to act from that station. So they are accomplishing things, even though...
Hurting people is the government's business. Protesters don't prevent them from doing that.
Well, I think they do.
I see what you mean from the point, but I think that, you know, it is a protest, and a protest is a protest in that, you know, it's a demonstration, you know, and that's, and it is a PR, it's a big, and it's basically...
You don't protest in front of wolves. You get eaten. I'm sorry. Yeah, not yeah, a, you don't make a yeah, point that I, way.
Yes, but I, sometimes... I can agree with you.
But hold on, it's like Chris said, it's a big public relations things right now. So basically they're calling the bluff. They're saying, yep. Hey, okay, we're peaceful, we're not going to do anything wrong, and not only that, we're cleaning up, it's like Burning Man protesters. They clean up all their shit, you know? It's like Leave No Trace protesting, you know? And they're, exactly. And they're like the most polite protesters I've ever seen on video ever, and I don't know how they can do it. I can't do, like you said, I could never be that polite in front of the wolves. I just go away because I know there's no use for me to be there, you know? But they are and it's kind of like, and in itself, that is kind of, it's very dangerous, and we see the danger of it, and we see what the government is going to do.
Since you brought up Gandhi.
And I think that what is important is kind of what, a little bit of what you're saying is that, yeah, there has to be, what's going to happen when the protests are over? You know, what's going to come from all this? Because it's going to be clear that they're not going to get all their demands. So I hope that people are also thinking about that, so that you make new relationships, you meet people, you maybe create a kind of a business or a network of, you know, helping each other, and you met through this whole thing, this whole art and this whole thing that happened. And I hope that that's what happens, is that it's a joining of all these resources and not just, you know, like a one-off action and then that's over.
I agree with Theo. I hope that it becomes Occupy Everywhere, because that's what I didn't like about the Occupy movement. They weren't forming up into groups, taking down names, organizing local committees. There wasn't an emphasis on using the internet for organization, which would have allowed them to become a lasting force. The protesters in this case, Theo brought up the word bluff, and I think that's a good way to describe it because it's a case of brinksmanship. At first, it was going to be a two-day protest. The government came in with heavy police. The protesters expanded, more heavy police, more expansion. It's back and forth. And remember, this is a very unique point geographically and historically. This is the one Chinese / non-Chinese province. What goes down here is presumably being watched by the rest of mainland China. And I'm sure you guys all remember the Arab Spring. As I recall, I think it was started by like a hot dog vendor or something on the street who was beaten by police. And people were tired of it. They just had enough. They're like, why are they beating this hot dog vendor? Pretty soon it's a local riot, then it's a larger riot, then the entire government of Egypt, the entire government of Libya, these other governments are shaking because of this idea of we've had enough.
And 3 years later, nothing has changed.
They have new dictators. They have new leaders. I mean, they have other options. And plus, people remember the power of the people. Once this power of the people has been exercised, they'll go back to it and they'll remember it.
That is not the power of the people.
Managed to wipe out Tiananmen Square, but they haven't wiped out the Occupy protests or the Arab Spring protests.
I could not disagree with you more. People are so much more powerful when they put their creative efforts towards producing things rather than standing out into the streets and shouting. That is not a way to accomplish anything. As you point out yourself, a couple of the real-world examples, like the Arab Spring have resulted in nothing but more tyranny, more dictators, no more freedom for the people. And I'll remind you, since
you on where you put the end line.
I'll remind you of the Amritsar massacre.
Where you put the end. The Arab Spring is not over. I don't think that the Hong Kong protests are over, nor do I think that the Occupy movement's over. If you look at it on a larger canvas, we have a series of decentralized, distributed, internet-based revolutions that are getting better and better, more and more efficient. Whereas for the first time, the control methods, if you look at the rest of history, you see a repetition and an improving of control methods. This is the first time that the protests have actually gotten better. Go ahead, Derek.
We're taking a look right now at the Wikipedia page for the Amritsar massacre. It was the seminal event in the British rule of India. And if those of you aren't familiar with the brief history, I'll just count that people were gathering in a crowd similar to the types of protests you're describing. They were protesting in India, and the army fired on the crowd for 10 minutes, directly firing their bullets largely towards the few open gates. And you can see what that looks like. I'm going to share on the screen some of these open gates where over 1,000 people were just killed. They were peacefully protesting as they were demanding change in their government. The government just took guns, pointed them at them, and then killed them. Yeah, you could say India is more free now. I wouldn't argue with that. There's measurably more freedom in India, but I wouldn't say that that is... I think there are many ways to achieve the goal of more freedom, and thousands of people dead is not something to celebrate. And so when I see people going out into the streets to protest, I say, I'm worried for you. I want you to have freedom, but I don't think that's a good way to do it. Historically, it ends up with people dying, and I think there are safer ways to do it.
I think that we have to also look at all of these examples and not... It's more complicated. I mean, we could have a whole discussion about it, but I mean... in India, you know, Gandhi met with the British and kind of, you know, they kind of got together, and that might be one reason why India isn't as free. And in Libya, you know, there were like, you know, mercenaries, and there was, you know, America fired a Tomahawk missile into Libya, so it wasn't just, you know, a simple uprising in a lot of these cases. It's a lot more complicated, and I think that we need to also do that. But I agree with Derek that people need to be just do stuff. That's why I said earlier, less talk, more rock. Even though we're talking right now, and this is a whole talk network, you know, the thing is that what I meant was kind of like another slogan, kind of like Wendy's, where's the beef? You know, so when you like what Derek is saying is like what I would say, talk. You know, so they're rah, 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 we don't want this, rah, 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 you know? Yeah, but where's the beef? What are you doing? Where's the productivity? Where's your, you know, what did you make?
They're producing art and they're teaching each other things.
No, I agree. I like that. I'm just saying in general that, you know, as protest as a means in general alone is not enough.
And that's why they need to add networking and organizing. The people need to be organizing in the street, maybe through an app on their phone, maybe through Fire Chat, but it's building a network. They need structure, and they need to be able to do this again. Once you can get people out in the street, you need to show the forces about that you can do it again. And maybe get them to line up like a marching band.
With people in the streets. That is romanticism that people have about, like, oh, this is what it should look like when people protest. People should be in the streets. That is so old world. We live in the internet age now. People in the streets doesn't even make any sense.
It's not enough people then. You need more people. It's worked for thousands of years. It'll keep working. They redesigned the city of Paris to prevent invasion. They have actually prevent control by the people. They have 5 different spokes coming in on the star so that you can move tanks in. Like Brian Sovereign said, we can basically look at cities as military restaging depots where the streets are all wide enough to roll the tanks through.
Yeah. So in Tel Aviv, the roads are wide enough to park planes on, actually land and take off.
Exactly, because they're prepared, and we need to be prepared. We need to be organizing and networking, not just showing up once. It's not just a picnic, it's a long-term party. I don't know what else. What else have you guys got? We were going to be joined by someone from BitNation. Is that still going on, Chris? That was about.
So I'm in the chat as you've been talking about world revolutions. I've been talking to Suzanne because she jumped in and she saw my tweet and she's like, "Let me just read out what she said, actually." So the person you've been talking to hasn't been involved in the setting up of the multisig. She says he has no clue at all because he wasn't involved in the setting up of the multisig. She has named Michael Perkins as the person who has set up the procedure for buying the XBNs. She is claiming that this is also the same person that set it up for Ethereum. Now, I've also been doing a little bit of research. It's not quite the same as it's set up with Ethereum, so she is going to have to come on air and clarify this for us because I double-checked this because that's the essence of journalism, verification, fact-checking, CoinDesk, hi, is that every time you bought the Ether through Ethereum, it automatically generated you a new address and then forwarded those funds onto the multi-signature that everyone sees on the blockchain. And that is what Michael is claiming. I've also been told that he's a very reputable crypto consultant as well, and that he has set this up so that it is as transparent and safe as possible for the key holders. So an issue that's been brought up by both Suzanne and my other source are saying that, look, if you start publishing the names of the multisig holders, that puts them and their families at great risk. You know, they could have personal threats made against them. You don't want this going on there. And I have thought about this before, but I sort of figured, well, yeah, but there are lots of millionaires and billionaires in the world, and do they worry? Do people generally like go around pointing guns at them? I mean, if you've got a multi-sig and you need 5 signatures to get the money out or 3 signatures to get the money out, it's going to take quite an operation to coordinate kidnappings strategically in different parts of the globe. And then what's wrong with just putting the keys in a safety deposit box and leaving instructions with the company that runs the building that you should only ever let me in when I'm on my own and there's nobody else there, and you know, and maybe there's a series of questions that I have to answer, and if I answer them in a certain way, you know, to raise the alarm secretly, and things, lots of things that you can do. But yeah, it's not an easy issue. The problem is this, though, that A, it's not quite the same as the way Ethereum set it up, because Ethereum set up an automatic change of address, and then I believe it automatically went onto the multisig, thus giving us the funds straight away. However, it doesn't appear to be the case because I set up. Oh, I've lost all my windows. Please hold. Okay, here we go. So let me show you. This is the same address that Tom showed earlier on, exactly the same address. And also, if you check this address on the blockchain, it still has all the funds in there. So the funds haven't been automatically diverted to the multi-signature wallet, which would start with a 3. So the problem is this address starts with a 1, which means there is one key holder of this address, which means that this person could at any time just walk away with the funds. Now, it's also the case that the person holding the multi-signature could be comprised of, sure, 8 keys, but what if all of the 8 keys are owned by the same person? The blockchain doesn't reveal the identity of the person holding the keys. So sure, you can put up a multi-signature address and claim that you've got 7 people who own it or whatever the number is, but you've got no way of proving that. Now, when we generate our multi-sigs, we do it live on air, and you can see that creation, and then you see the resulting address, and we can each, if you really wanted us to, I'm sure we'd be prepared to sign a transaction on the blockchain with each individual key to prove that it's
up. The creation process is really important, Chris, because even if you distribute the 7 other keys, you could have made a copy of those keys in private. So the 7 yeah. other people could never know that you've already owned the process from the beginning.
Mm-hmm. So, okay, so again, it doesn't look like Suzanne is lying. It just looks like she's not communicating well. And again, maybe she herself doesn't understand this. Maybe she has had it explained to her, and either she hasn't heard it properly or she's not understanding it, and so she's not communicating it properly. But at the moment, this doesn't look very transparent. All the money's going to one address. That the private keys, we don't know who owns the private keys to these. So yeah, the one thing is the transparency of BitNation. It looks like there are more question marks over it. And number two is, yeah, I don't know. It's a hard issue when talking about the personal safety. I totally understand that if I was holding one of the keys to an $18 million, you know, crowdfunding campaign, yeah, sure, I would feel like I might need to look after myself. And also remember, that's not my money, right? So it's not like I'm actually rich enough to get my own security. I'll tell you what I would do, though, if I was one of those key holders for Ethereum. I'd damn well demand my own personal security as part of the job. That's got to be in the package, or I'm walking away from the project. Like, this isn't big enough. I'll go to your hackathons and I'll take part. See, in a way, I've got the best deal, because I still get to go to the hackathons. I still get to learn it all and take part and be a part of the open source project, but I don't have to hold the keys. Who'd want that job anyway? I think someone's got to sort this out. I could actually see a lucrative business for companies that set up physical locations where perhaps you can only transfer the funds at certain times. So you can only transfer the funds on a Wednesday or something like that. And what you'd have to do is deliberately stagger the key signing so that it would be very, very difficult for an adversary to strategically line up a bunch of kidnappings across the world. I definitely see there are causes for concern, but we have to address this. Otherwise, all you've got is the illusion of transparency.
And it's important for the BitNation people to be upfront and public with their communications. Yes, they're having a crisis. Yes, it's hard to get the right story out, but you need to get the right story out. You need to tell the people what you're actually doing. The lessons of that Galt Gulch place are right here for us. One person held the keys. One person stole the money. One person had an exit. Everyone else got screwed. The people building the project who believed in it, the people donating to the project who believed in it. I even reported on the project. I feel a little pissed off. I talked about that stupid thing. And you barely hear about it going down, but you certainly heard about it going up. And that's what PR is. That's what could be happening here.
There's also another real simple danger, and it's not even with the key getting stolen. Because let's say, this is another worst case, though, but let's just say that, what is the name of the financial regulation organ in America? I forgot. FinCEN or whatever?
There are so many.
Federal Reserve. Well, let's just say, for example, that you're an employee at that startup, and you since you're an employee and not the, you know, the CEO, you come in early in the morning and you get the mail and you're like, okay, what the hell is this? And you open it up and it's a really nasty letter from the government authorities, and they're like, yeah, you didn't do this and we're gonna fine you and you gotta give us all the, and you're like, oh shit, this is gonna be the end of the project or we're gonna have to pay a lot of money. And what do? You dump all of the tokens, or you panic and sell all the Bitcoin that you raised because you know that the project's over. It doesn't mean that would happen. I'm not saying, but I'm just saying it's a possibility if someone had control of it.
Bear whale? Do you think they went bear whale on them, Theo?
Well, that's one of my conspiracy theories. So I've got two conspiracy theories about the bear whale. One conspiracy theory is exactly that. So there's all this all the rumors going around, right? Well, yeah, that was someone got one of the letters and they dumped. You know, they got one of these letters about the 5th of November or 4th of November, actually, or something related to that, and they were like, forget it, I'm out. It's a, you know, for me, I'm panicking. And the other conspiracy theory is more complicated, and that's about minor companies colluding together to keep the price low in order to keep the difficulty low, because they have secret ASICs that are running out that they've developed, and in order to maximize profit with them, they need to keep them running with the difficulty at the lowest level, and they've calculated this over a longer period of time. But since I don't have those numbers and I can't calculate, I can't prove my theory, but it's just a weird conspiracy theory that I thought of.
I like that, secret ASICs. That could be a lot of different books. I could see a lot of different strange books from that title, Secret ASICs. We've got a couple more questions from the question and answers. Let me just go through these really quick. It's loading. He said, yes, it's the free one in Cyprus, probably referring to that earlier item. He says, any protest that's not coupled with being streamed on the streamed live on the internet is rendered useless, if not straight up counterproductive in my book. It's important to stream the protest, but it's also important to build the organization for afterwards. The Occupy Wall Street could have used a lot more organization. And this is from the same guy, another comment. Derek is right. Protesting 1.0 is old and ineffective beyond a romantic gesture. It worked for thousands of years, yes, Tom, but we have a new thing called the internet for the first time in history. This changes things. So I see you guys are going all slacktivist on your protests. We should just put up banners on our websites and deny people access to services that they like to use. Is that really going to change things?
What? No, that's not what it's about. One of the examples that does really change things, I think, is art. And Chris brought this up as one of the things that people are doing during their protests in Hong Kong. And this has happened in the U.S., I think, to great effect by one artist named Assam, who put up fake NYPD drone posters around New York City, put them up in the telephone booths and bus stops, and they looked like real advertisements for the NYPD. But they said, warning, drone location, you may be droned at this bus stop, or, you know, something similar to that. And the NYPD had a horrible time getting these reports, like, what? Lady, you don't know what you're talking about. We don't have anything like that up in the, you know, and they're like, no, really, there are these horrible banners. Anyway, he's facing serious charges, felonies and stuff, because he pushed out into the national dialogue this talk about drones. And yeah, it's happening overseas, but people don't really think about it happening here at home. And when you put it in front of people's faces in a place like New York City, I think that does more good than any size march against drones.
I disagree. It depends on the size of the march. As a silver miner says here, Irish protesters have been protesting the installation of water meters for months. Only when it hit 100,000 people in Dublin did the media cover it. So it's important to keep it going.
Did anything change?
I think it's still going on.
It's not change. The media will cover the lottery winner. The media will cover, you know, a dog scratched its ass. The media will cover anything.
Anything
that people will need it. Pardon?
I think you'll especially like this next clip from Alexander Haig. He says, let them march all they want as long as they continue to pay their taxes.
That's right.
He's right on there, Derek.
Yeah, you're paying them to oppress you. You can stand there. We pay your taxes. That's what they were cheering.
You know, what we saw in Ferguson are thousands of people down there marching rah, rah, rah. If you look carefully at the photographs, you'll see they're all standing behind, guess what? A police car.
We had a comment from Christopher King, but it disappeared. It was something about how there were activists inside their groups at Occupy Wall Street, and you have to watch out for, they could be CIA, they could be fake activists, agent provocateurs. So that is a common cause. A lot of people will send in people to rile up the crowd, maybe get them to toss a Molotov cocktail. Once the cocktail is tossed, the protest is suddenly violent. All of the Gandhi techniques are out the window. So we do need to be on watch for that.
That's the best thing an activist could be doing. I can't believe I didn't even think about it or forgot about it. Yes, if James Bang is down there, one of the best things he could be doing with his time is not speaking to police or antagonizing them in any way. Stay away from police. Go to the protesters who are advocating violence and call them out. Let people know this person's a cop. Like, let them know this person's an instigator. They're trying to make violence happen. Let their face be on the camera.
We got that. We filmed them actually escorting this protester back to the police station. They took them around the block a couple of times.
That's right.
Yeah. And then when they got there, they started, like, loads of police officers started ganging up around the hallway to stop James from getting in.
That's powerful stuff, man. That's
in the blockchain. I timestamped that shit.
Boom. All right. where can we link back to that so I can check that?
Yeah, don't ask me that. Now I've got to go through all my hashes.
Was it a Christopher Coffee? Was it a what show was it?
It was. I'll have to find it, and then I'll put the link in the description.
Terrific. Yeah, that's great, because that's such a serious win. When you can go out, I mean, it's not sexy as a get out in the streets and shout and chant and be together. It's not as sexy to, you know, say go down to your don't get stopped for DUIs or don't get stopped and thrown in jail for possessing the wrong type of vegetation in their back pockets. You know, but that's not sexy. You don't see the changes happening right away. But I think that's where the real change happens. It's one mind at a time. One mind at a time being unlocked. That's where real change happens, not through thousands of people marching, having no idea what each other is really marching for. You know, they don't really have unified goals. They're just standing in their neighbors, and they're upset about something. Anyway, the internet gives us the ability to actually concentrate our efforts, work on something where we know what the same goals are. And the World Crypto Network is one example of that. So I think what we're doing is doing a lot more than any protest.
And Silver Miner agrees with Derek. He says, check out the Banksy art on the wall in Gaza. That brought more attention to it than anything else. Although the wall is still there. So let's see. Chris, so now you
can timestamp on the Doge blockchain.
With a Doge coin or with a what's it called counter Doge Doge party. That was it.
No, it's even easier. It's kind of like, and I like that. I like that because it's kind of like a paw print. Get it?
No. Shibe, moon, go to the moon. Yeah. Much wow. Fuck.
Yeah. Wow. Hold on. Here we go. See? Proof of Doge, timestamping. And all you do is you enter the SHA 100.
The Shibe approves.
Yes.
Oh, that's rubbish. SHA 256 is the standard. Don't have a hash to generate it.
Here and here. It's I like it that they make it really
easy. Go to the one of them.
Oh, here? Mm-hmm. It's an MD5file.com calculator.
Get rid of MD5 for a start.
Joe's WebTool Security SHA-1 hash.
Okay, yeah, if you upload the file or whatever. Yeah, okay. Yeah, but that's not as good as Crypto Graffiti. Yeah, right, let's go to Tom. Let's go to Tom.
I think it's a new thing. I mean, there's, you know, the blockchain notary on Clear Wallet, and now, you know, what you've been doing with the Crypto Graffiti, and I think that's people are noticing that that's an important thing that people need to be able to do, you know.
All right, let's go to
spreading.
Let's take a look at this. So this is the video, Derek. Let's check it out.
Are you able to unmute yourself? I'm not hearing it.
Click on his window, and then it will come up. So what they were going to do was they were just going to drop him off on public transport and let him go, and then he'll come back and do the same thing later on. But because they had the cameras on them, they couldn't do that. So instead, they're just walking around the block, and we're going around the block for like 10, 15 minutes until eventually they take him to the police station. And then they let him in, but then they crowd around. If you jump forward maybe a couple of minutes, because this goes on for some time, there you go. And then when they get him back, they take him inside, and then look, you perfect, you timed that. Well done, Tom. They've then like crowded around the doorway to stop James from getting in. He's in the foyer sort of parking area bit, you know, with a shelter over there. And they're just going to stand there. And later on, more students turning up as part of the protest, and then as kind of witnesses. They then go around to the other exits, and then later on they'll actually send out this kind of drunken, well, we're not sure if he was like one of the police or whether he was just a drunken thug, but anyway, James thought that that was designed to scare him.
It's scaring me. It's very uncomfortable to watch this type of tyranny, to see humans using their bodies to prevent humans to have freedom.
Yeah, I agree.
Which is one of the reasons why I wish people just avoided it. I think there are other more creative ways to oppose this, But of course, we do have to see it. That's part of it. We have to see that it's happening. So kudos to James for having the courage to stand so close and capture this video, which I think is historical, instantly historical photo, video. Just essential. Another essential activist tool is a two-way communicator, radio. Mm. These are simple devices. You can pick them up at any corner store for relatively cheap. And they're the best way that I know of still to get a message across to a wide group of people within maybe a mile range, especially if you've got something like a close range protest like that. Police still use these today. The reason? They're effective. So go ahead and pick yourself up some. They're cheap and effective. Go use one.
That's a good point, Derek. And in a situation like this, communication is important. If the protesters had better organization, better communication, they could tell where the police were, where they were moving to, and they could move their own forces around in response. So,
right.
That's very cool.
I was able to use one of these, and they're useful on many accounts, but just one example is when Rick Santorum came to Keene, New Hampshire, as part of his campaign. He was a politician in the U.S., and all of the media was standing out waiting for him in front of this library where he was due to appear. We had a few activists with video cameras and two-way radios, and we were around the perimeter. Turns out he came around the back door. No surprise for Santorum. And we were to communicate to each other that he was around the back, and none of the mainstream media was able to get video of him. The only people who were able to get video were the independent activists because we had two-way communicators.
Are they peer-to-peer, or do they go through like a mesh? Do they go through like antennas that are up, or they go peer-to-peer?
Person-to-person. Goes right to you. We also have in Keene, we have something special set up so that we've got a repeater. So if you want to get really technical about it, you can have an antenna up in a high point in your city. Mm-hmm. If you've got an apartment that's way up high, stick an antenna out your window, and then you're giving people a lot of range. All they have to do is be able to hit that antenna, and then it bounces out. It can spread for miles. So these two-way communicators, I've been able to reach over 20 miles. Because
imagine if we could put... But go back to, like, remember 56K dial-up? So what we could do is actually use these to create pseudo-mesh networks. Yeah, why not, actually?
Send Bitcoin through these.
Can you?
Yes.
That's brilliant.
It's slow, but it takes a while. There's a special program you can, like, hook it in through the side. It figures out how to translate the,
that is cool.
the radio signal.
How do you do that?
I don't know. There's just some simple program for it. I've never found it useful. It would take a while.
What's the sound of it?
What sound does it make?
Mm-hmm.
When it's receiving Bitcoin?
Yeah.
If that's what you're asking.
Yeah, that's what I want to hear.
No, I don't know what it does, but
I suppose you just plug the headphone socket into an input in the computer, I'm guessing.
It plugs into a USB, and you can program these. Like I had to program it once to get the channels to say, like, when I turn it on, it says, "Hello, Derek."
Oh, that's cool.
But I had, you know, you could program them, and they're cheap. This one is like $30, and the range is like 2 miles.
Really?
Yeah,
it's very cool.
Okay, so you need a government license to operate them, but if you don't get one, they still work. So.
You say, don't tell anyone.
But, I mean, seriously, if you're an activist and you're trying to be out in a protest and you could be in danger, you know, your couple of your friends have video cameras. If you get arrested and you can whisper into this thing real quick, I mean, you've got 20 people who now know about it who can run over to your aid with a video camera, where you can't do that with a text message. You can't do that with any other technology. I know it's an old tech, but it's still useful. And if apocalypse ever comes, you can still transact Bitcoin with these things. So very handy.
In case of apocalypse, buy radios. Are they CB radios? Is that what it is, Derek?
You need to buy the radio before the apocalypse. You need to be prepared, not
prepared.
This is a dual band marine band radio, so it does do CB as well as marine band.
All right, dual band marine band radio. I think that's a pretty good note to close up on. Chris, are you about ready to close this program?
Yeah, we can do. We're waiting for Suzanne, but I think it would be better if we just did a separate show for Suzanne. So if any of you guys are around in the next hour or so, I'm hoping that she'll be free and we can ask her about the multi-sig. Maybe also because the problem is that we haven't really, I mean, we had her side yesterday, but it was more of like the audience couldn't really get involved. It was more very contextual to the London scene. So it would be nice, given how much time we've dedicated to it, because, you know, clearly her heart is in this. She believes in this vision of hers. So however it may look to us on the outside, I definitely think she deserves to be listened to. And if she's coming back and she's saying, look, this thing, this multi-sig is, you know, is legitimate, then she deserves to get her voice heard. So if any of you on here want to stick around, Theo, Derek, Tom, that'd be great, because I don't want to do it. I don't want it to just be her and me. I'd rather have like a small group where we can bounce questions around.
Yeah, I agree with that. She deserves her own segment where we can address this single issue and just take it head on.
Yeah, I agree.
All right, I think that's about it for today's Bitcoin Talk Show. So check in again next Wednesday around noon on the West Coast. That's 3 o'clock on the East Coast. And check back soon in the next half hour or so. We should be joined by Suzanne from BitNation. Bye-bye.